Back home today. Is everybody still cool? The wind making it better?
No.
Sort of?
Turn the AC higher.
A little bit higher? Alright. Well, it's on. You can feel it. So that's good. Alright guys, we'll be really quick this afternoon. Sort of a short word, but I was on my way here and I didn't get a chance to do it, but I was going to do it. I was going to buy a lottery ticket. I was. I know. That shocked many of you. I know. Look at Ian. He's put his head down right there. He's like, oh no.
He's watering it too.
You were? Yes, I was going to buy a lottery ticket. I was going to prove a point, of course. Had the lottery ticket won, rest assured, I would have paid my tithes to Missions of Love, for sure. No, but the goal of the actual talk today is to talk about faith. And it's a talk about how sure we are in where we're going in our lives and how much of our lives we have to place in our faith and trust in God. So this afternoon, I just want to talk about faith, not a bet. Faith, not a bet. All right? This morning, I was thinking about a lottery ticket. I've never actually played the lottery. I've seen it done, though. I've researched it many times on the internet. I've been in 7-Eleven. I've looked at the things. I've seen all the advertisements. You know, double your wins. You know, for $1 more. Get the Powerball. You know, so on and so forth. And I've thought about it. And I sat and I thought, on one of the key lottery tickets that you can actually get for $1, the Florida lottery, you get a chance to pick out of, 100 numbers? Up to 6 numbers, 5 different brackets, you know. And the idea is, when they draw the actual winning numbers, get one of your numbers on each bracket. Now, you got 6 shots on each bracket to get it right. You know, so you got 6 chances to produce a winning lottery combination. And then based on whatever the pot is at that time, you know, $2 million or whatever, you actually win the lottery and you cash in your ticket and you take your money. Now, I think the lottery got recently up to a pretty high. We had an actual Florida winner, got up to $187 million. Now, I want you to take just a minute, just for fun, and think, what could I do? $187 million.
Go straight to hell.
any you know, bright ideas? You know, anything that you
buy
could do. What's the first thing you do with $187 million? Anybody?
Buy my
Ask
Mustang.
Ask God for guidance on how to spend it.
Oh wow! All right, you're a good one. Ask
I would
God
buy
for
my
how to
I
spend
would
it.
Buy my Mustang. Or
right.
My Dodge Charger.
She'd buy a Dodge Charger, Eric.
Sure.
A tank.
A tank.
Oh,
all right. That's.
That's not right.
Okay. You know, whatever it is you'd like to do, that's cool. Share money, Greg. Mm-hmm.
Me?
Yeah.
I'd find 5 or 6 needy ministries and tithe to each one of them.
You are a good one. 5 or 6 needy ministries, and he'd give money to that first thing. Excellent. Deja, any plans?
I think I'd die in disbelief.
All right. She would die of disbelief. She never even
I want to inherit.
Spend the money. There you go. And hey, Caleb, any good thoughts? New suits?
How about get some braces?
No. I want to be your beneficiary.
Yeah?
He needs to be cool and buy some braces for himself.
There you go.
Oh, I
cool kids club braces there. Any Tito, anything?
I bought a whole bunch of toes from Jordan.
I believe Tito would buy a car
Jordan,
lot.
Yeah.
I believe he would start Tito's used cars, I believe. Any,
Oh, that's nasty, Caleb.
Yeah, new lot.
Oh, here comes Kimberly, ask her. Here comes Kimberly, ask her.
Yeah, Kim, what would you do with $187 million?
Nasty.
I'd
go to Hawaii.
Okay, Hawaii, she says. Now, that
exactly
I haven't heard that. Go on vacation.
Oh, they're real clear.
Some of them.
I'd say, hey, Jackie, that's where I'd be. Right,
you're going to Hawaii with her.
Anything at all. That's not bad. Kim, what would you do, Kayla? Anything? You don't know?
I knew.
Not sure? Okay, wow.
Give it to me.
Yes, if you don't know what to do with it, give it to me. I will be sure to take
it out. She's figured out real fast.
So as you can see, just the prospect, man, $187 million. I'm sure if we could all go down the list, we'd say, man, you know, right after we maybe took care of charities first, handle out 10%, and maybe we might look at, of course, opening. Then we got to have bank day. We got to go to the bank, you know, we got to set up certain accounts. Say what?
Uncle Sam's not
going to
let you have it.
True. Very true. Uncle Sam gets his cut. That's right. Uncle Sam gets his cut. That's right. Now let's just say, right. Let's just say after taxes, you end up with $91 million. That's still not bad.
And
they took most of it. That's not bad. So, yeah. So you get all of that. You have a lot of extra funds. You got bank day. You got to go open accounts because you're not in regular accounts anymore. You're now in wealth management at this point. So you got to get new accounts. You got all sorts of things that you got to handle. How many of you guys would probably pay your debts? Make sure that there's not a scrap of paper with your name on it with a balance at all. You make sure that's taken care of. How many of you guys would look after your kids? Make sure your kids are taken care of. Mary Bell, you should give your parents some money. You got to get parents. Make sure parents are taken care of, so and so forth. So it's not bad. And there's all sorts of things that we could be doing with it. But here's the funny thing. As quick as we talk about how we might actually spend the money, the getting it, that's the tough part. I actually come by $187 million. I'm with Deja. You'd be in such disbelief, because... we work hard every day, we go through struggles and trouble and turmoil. And even when you're working hard and you get to a place where, great, things are starting to get comfortable now. Car accident or something horrible happens. You get sick, you got to miss work, anything. As soon as you start getting things stabilized, bam, there you go. There's life. Hits you right in the jaw again, And that's how a lot of it is. And I looked at the lottery ticket and I thought to myself, I give away a dollar, just a small fraction, just at the opportunity, the chance to be able to make my life a little bit better, monetarily speaking, a lot better. And I began to think, I said, well, man, God, I know a lot of people. And this was actually funny. I said, God, I know a lot of people who will buy this lottery ticket. And then they'll take that lottery ticket to church. Put it on the altar and pray, oh God, if you will let this lottery ticket win, I will serve you forever. Or better yet, we know him, Caleb. In the name of Jesus, this lottery ticket, I have faith. This lottery ticket is going to win. And then we go all around and we're like, yes. And then everybody has to say, hey, how you doing? Blessed and highly favored. I'm about to come into some money. Money's coming to me in Jesus' name. And we all that. We have people that'll do that. They'll bring in the checks and they'll bring in the lottery ticket. They'll pray over it and so on and so forth. And I thought to myself, man, that's kind of silly. Well, what about other people that really need it too? What about the other people that need the $187 million? It's got to come to you. And I got to thinking, and I got to thinking about other things. That just spawned off a whole thing of thought about how many people will say, oh, I have faith here, I have faith there, I have faith this is going to happen, I have faith this is going to happen. I pray, and then I have faith that this is going to happen. Hey, God, I need a new car. I pray in faith, and in Jesus' name, I'm going to get a car. And then they expect a car to show up, or somebody to walk up and give you the keys, or anything like that. God moves like that, but most of the time, He just makes a way. It doesn't always happen the way we look at it. It doesn't always happen the way we'd like to have it. And how many of you guys know that anything worth having in this world is worth working for? It's worth pushing for. And faith is not a mystical powder that makes things appear. It is simply, and I'll give you a definition that will change the way you look at the Bible. And I'm already almost done. I want you to just hear this definition. We look in Hebrews, the Bible says that faith, does anybody know the scripture, Hebrews 11:1? Faith is the substance of things not seen, the evidence of things hoped for, right? Does that really make sense? I mean, think about it. Does it really make sense? The evidence, the substance of things not seen. So I can't see it, but it is there. Then it's the evidence of things hoped for. So this is something that's not even there yet. I'm hoping for it. But I have evidence that it's going to come around. I'll give you a deeper definition. Faith, listen to this, is simply knowing God. Well, that doesn't make sense. Doesn't make sense at all. Well, I tell you what, if you take that definition and place it anywhere in the Bible where you see the word faith, it completely changes the whole meaning of the scripture. Completely. Try it. From here on out, anytime you see faith, think in your mind, knowing God. Now I'll tell you how this makes sense. And this will help you along throughout the week, I think. If you gain faith as the definition of simply knowing God, then that truly means something different. And I'll give you an example, okay? Now, I can look, Greg, and I can say, Greg looks about 48 years old. I'm going to say you look about 48. I'm going to say 48. Okay? Now, I go and I tell Daisha, I say, hey, Daisha. She says, how old is Greg? I think he's about 48. Right? Now, Daisha goes to her mother, and mother says, man, I wonder how old Greg is. He's looking kind of wrinkly. And Daisha could say, well, yeah, Greg's 48. Yeah, he is. And then she comes back to Pastor Ian, and Ian says, yeah, I wonder how old Greg is. Oh, he's 48. Oh, 48, okay, great, good stuff. Comes back around to Greg, and Ian decides he's going to use Greg as an example. He says, Greg's 48. And Greg says, I am not, I'm 62.
12.
You know, or whatever his age is. I'm going to leave his age as a mystery, but here's the thing. Out of all of us guessing what Greg's age was. And the more people we talked to, the more it became a fact. You know, that's how rumors get started. You know? Oh, did you hear that Tom Hanks was on drugs? Oh, yeah, I heard that. He sounds like that kind of guy. And then you go off and there you go. It's a fact. All of a sudden, it's the truth. You know, that's what happens. So, around a couple of people, all of a sudden, Greg's age has become a fact. Now, here's the thing. Nobody ever went to Greg, asked him how old he was. Now, Greg knows how old he is, okay? I know how old I am. I can only guess how old he is. And the only way it will become the absolute truth to me is if I get it right from him, how old he is. But I know how old I am. You can't come to me and say, well, Micah, you're 33. No, I'm not. I know how old I am. Are you getting a little taste of this, guys? The faith we have today is very shaky. Because we're getting it, yes, faith cometh by hearing. But watch this, hearing by the word of God. Now, change the meaning that I gave you. Knowing God comes by hearing. And you're only able to hear by what he said. Simple, isn't it? Faith, knowing God. Ask in faith. Ask in a knowledge of God. I'll give you an example about that. Maribel knows what she can get away with Ian.
Nothing.
She knows what she can get away with Ian. Why? She's tried him. My kids try me. If you have kids, they've tried you. It's natural. And they get to a point where they know. I know. You know. And then your friends start talking with you. Hey, what if we do this? I know my mom, my dad, she's going to be such a buzzkill. You know, I know.
Buzzkill.
You know? And that's the thing. We have to know God. That's what faith is all about. Salvation, faith, getting to know him, what he wants of us, what he needs of us.
Amen.
And so when we're looking at, you know, faith healing or God, you know, and we wonder, has anybody ever wondered why people are good people and they get sick and then God doesn't heal them? Have you ever wondered that? Consider maybe the faith part of it. If we consider that, yes, it's God's will that all of us be healed. But according to faith, it might be God's will that that person be going through that particular thing at that particular time. Faith is very specific. It's not broad. It's very specific. And if you're going to have faith in God, you need to have a precise knowledge of what God's will is for your life. Not the person next to you, and not just because the pastor gets up on Sunday and says, oh, I believe that someone here is suffering from a headache. That's not faith. It's 9 times out of 10 odds that somebody's got a headache. Especially if you're yelling. Just saying. Faith is specific enough to point to an individual, their situation, their circumstance. And the only way you'd have that knowledge, that solidified knowledge, is to know God. Jesus stood on a boat and looked around in the midst of all the uncertainty. And because he knew in his spirit who he was and what he had, he was able to say, peace be still. And then he's done. And he says to us, have faith in God. Have a knowledge of him to where that when you ask, you know you're asking what you know. So that way it's not shaky. And if you know that God is able to heal you and you know that it's your time, for you to be healed and you know that this is the place, then you ask, God, heal me. And it happened.